morning to everyone and good evening to everyone elsewhere in the world. So we are looking at polar vortexes. What are polar vortexes? So basically they are a natural phenomena. It's a cold air which resides on near the poles on both the hemisphere on Earth. And so the polar vortexes are not something new. The term polar vortex has only been recently popularized, bringing attention to weather feature that has always been present. It is also not a feature that exists at Earth's surface. Weather forecasts examine the polar vortex by looking at conditions tens of thousands of feet above in the atmosphere. So it is not a surface phenomena on Earth. However, when we feel extremely cold air from the Arctic regions at Earth's surface, it is sometimes associated with polar vortex. This is not confined to the United States. Portions of Europe and Asia also experience cold surges connected to the polar vortex. By itself, the only danger to humans is the magnitude of how cold temperatures will get when polar vortex expands, sending Arctic air southwards into areas that are not typically that cold. In short, there is no cause to be alarmed when you hear about polar vortex, but you should be prepared for colder temperatures if you are living close to the poles or in the areas, you know, in the subpolar region. Check the forecast for your weather, and so it is talking for emergency. It's not usually an emergency situation as such. Now we will move on to the next. I was on question number 16, which was about polar vortex. Now, question number 16 has been solved, so I will just move on to the another question. Okay. So, question number 16 is this, which was about polar vortex, and the question number 17 is Nuwakhai Juhar is one of the most ancient festivals celebrated in Odisha. Is associated with which of the following? So, is this a Buddhist New Year? No, Buddhist New Year is associated with Buddh Purnima, we call it as, and Jagannath Rath Yatra is another Yatra which happens. So when do Jagannath Yatra happens? Now this can be a good question. So Jagannath Rath Yatra. So when does it happen? This particular Rath Yatra. So this Rath Yatra. Rath Yatra Puri is a Hindu festival associated with Lord Jagannath, one of the avatars of Lord Vishnu, which happens in Puri. Is a chariot festival, is a Hindu festival associated with Lord Jagannath, is the oldest Rath Yatra taking place in India and in the world, whose descriptions can be found in Brahma Purana, Padma Puran, Skanda Puran, Kapila Samhita. Okay, Kapila Samhita. This annual festival is celebrated at Ashad Shukla Paksha Dvitya, second day of the Ashad month. Okay, so it is Shukla Paksha Dvitya of the Shukla Paksha. The festival commemorates Jagannath's annual visit to Gundicha temple via Mausi Ma temple, maternal aunt Mausi Ma temple near Sarada Bali. Puri. So, Jagannath, the festival of chariots of Sri Jagannath is celebrated everywhere here at Puri, the temple town in Odisha. The second, the Dvitiya Shukla Paksha means when the earth is, when it's a waxing cycle, means it's moving towards Purnima in the Ashadha month. Ashadha month, second month, third month of the presiding deities of the Jagannath Puri temple, Lord Jagannath, Lord Balbhadra, and Goddess Subhadra. So, with celestial. So, who is Jagannath basically? Jagannath. So, who is Lord Jagannath? So, Jagannath formally is a deity worshipped in the Hindu. Let me see. So, there are three idols. Associated with that, so Jagannath, Lord of the Universe, formerly as a deity worshipped in the original Hindu traditions in India and Bangladesh as part of Triad, along with his brother Balbhadra and sister Devi Subhadra. Jagannath within Odia Hinduism is the supreme god Purushottam Parabrahman, and to most Vaishnav Hindus, particularly Krishnaites, Jagannath is an abstract representation of Krishna and Mahavishnu, sometimes the avatar of the Krishna or Vishnu. To some Shiva and Shakta Hindus, his symmetrical tantric form is Bhairava, a fierce manifestation of Shiva associated with annihilation. Jagannathism or Odia Vaishnavism, okay, is also known as Jagannathism. The particular sector of Jagannath as a major deity was emerged in the early Middle Ages and later became independent state regional temple centered tradition of Krishnaism, Vaishnavism. It's a tradition of, you know, the icon of Jagannath is carved and decorated wooden stump with large round eyes and a symmetric face. The icon has conspicuous absence of hands or legs. The worship procedures. So it is very important to understand that the icon of Jagannath has big eyes, large round eyes, and a symmetric face, but it doesn't have any limbs, does not have any hands or legs. So worship procedures, sacraments and rituals associated with Jagannath are syncretic and include rites that are uncommon in Hinduism. So it's a very peculiar same sort of rites which are performed from Lord Jagannath. Unusually, the icon is made of wood and replaced with a new one at regular intervals. The origin and evolution of Lord Jagannath is unclear. Some scholars interpret him 1053 of Jagannath's Rigveda is a possible origin, but others disagree and say that it's a synthetic deity with tribal roots. The English word Jagannath comes from the negative image of the deity presented by Christian missionaries in the 18th and 19th centuries. The Jagannath is considered a non-sectarian deity. He is significant regionally in the states of Odisha, Chhattisgarh, West Bengal, Jharkhand, Bihar, Gujarat, Assam, Manipur, Tripura. He is also significant to the Hindus of Bangladesh. The Jagannath temple in Odisha, particularly significant in Vaishnavism, is regarded as one of the Char Dham pilgrimage sites in India. The Jagannath temple is massive, with over 61 meters, 200 feet high, in the Nagar Hindu temple site. It is one of the best surviving specimens of Kalinga art architecture, namely Odisha art and architecture. It has been one of the major pilgrimage destinations for Hindus about 800 CE. The annual festival called Rath Yatra, celebrated in June or July in eastern states, is dedicated to Jagannath. His images, along with two associated deities, that is Balbhadra and Subhadra, of the chief temple in Jagannath Puri, Bada Deula, they are placed in a chariot which is then pulled by numerous volunteers of the Gundicha temple. They stay there for a few days, after which they are returned to the main temple. Coinciding with the Rath Yatra festival at Puri, similar processions are organized at Jagannath temples throughout the world. Though the festive public processions of Jagannath temples in Puri, lakhs of devotees visit Puri to see Jagannath in chariots. Jagannath is linked to Jag, the friend of the universe, Jag Bandhu. Other names, Jagannath, both names derived from Jagannath. Further, the basis of the physical appearance of these names, like Kalaya, the black colored lord, Kalaya, but which can also mean timely one. According to the Krishna Joshi, the word may have origins of tribal between the Sora people, Savaras. The Hieroglyphs states that Vedic people, as they settled in the tribal, adopted the tribal words and called the deity Jagannath. According to one scholar, it's unlikely because Kitung is one of the unrelated Kitung. The icon of Jagannath in his temples is a brightly painted. In Jagannath tradition, Lord Jagannath is the most frequently identified with the abstract form of Krishna as a supreme deity. Jagannath is considered equivalent to the Hindu philosophical concepts of Brahman, Parabrahman, Purushottam, Shunya Purush, wherein he is then the avatari. causal equivalence of all clouds in infinite existence in space and time, according to author Deepthi Ray. Okay. Stems from the Jagannatha conception triggered to Buddhism by Kalinda. For example, there exists unexamined relic in Jagannath Shankar in Puri, and local legends state that the shrine relic contains the tooth of the Gautam Buddha, a feature common to many cherished Theravada Buddhist shrines in and outside India. Other legends state that the shrine contains bones of the human incarnation of the Hindu god Krishna after he was accidentally killed by a deer hunter. However, in Hindu tradition, a dead body is cremated, ashes are returned to nature, and the mortal remains and bones are not preserved or adored. Preserving the skeletal parts such as Buddha's tooth or relics of dead saints is a thriving tradition. The existence there of these legends in some scholars in Jagannath may have a Buddhist origin. However, this is a weak justification because some other traditions, such as those in Jainism and tribal folk, do have instances of preserving the legendary relics of the dead. And then we have Nuakhai Juhar. So Nuakhai Juhar is a festival. Which tribe celebrates this particular festival? So Nuakhai Juhar is the festival that I was looking into. So it is a Nuakhai Juhar, which is extension greetings with friends and well wishers, and this symbolizes unity. It's Western Odisha and Southern Chhattisgarh in India. Nuakhai is observed to welcome new rise of the season. According to the calendar, it is Pancham Tithi of the lunar solstice in the month of Bhadrapad or Bhadraba, the day after Ganesh Chaturthi festival. So it is the day after Ganesh Pancham Tithi. Chaturthi ko Ganesh Chaturthi hai Bhadrapad mein, and after that, in the Pancham Tithi, after Ganesh Chaturthi, Nuakhai is celebrated. Okay, so it basically has a very, it's a kind of a tribal festival. It's a new rice, it's a harvest of the new rice. Is it harvest or is it which? It's a welcome to the new rice. Okay, so details of the rituals of the Nuakhai. Okay. So it's a most important social festival in Western Odisha, and enjoying Simdega in Jharkhand, where culture of the Western Odisha is much more prominent over there, and it is celebrated a day after Ganesh Chaturthi. So that it is, it's one of the most ancient celebrated. So it is to welcome the new harvest of the rice. It's a new rice, okay, which is harvested during September. That is Ashar, month of. Not Ashar, the month of Bhadrapad. Ashar is Jagannath Yatra. Okay, new cropping season. Okay, and so it is associated with new cropping season of what? Of rice. And areas of which of the following wildlife sanctuary has upgraded to tiger reserve? Meghamalai Wildlife Sanctuary, Krishnapur Wildlife Sanctuary, Sri Penusila Narasimha Wildlife Sanctuary, Mahananda Wildlife Sanctuary. I think it is Meghamalai Wildlife Sanctuary. Let me check the answer. 18A. That is Meghamalai Wildlife Sanctuary has been Tamil Nadu has been created to tiger reserve. Why has it been, and what is the process of making a wildlife sanctuary into a tiger reserve? Tiger reserves are declared by National Tiger Conservation Authority via Wildlife Protection Amendment Act 2006 under centrally sponsored scheme called Project Tiger. To declare an area as a tiger reserve, the state governments can forward their proposals to NTCA, and then NTCA is a nodal authority, has a power, is a deciding authority whether that particular wildlife sanctuary will be a wildlife park. But these legal legislations have a direct effect on the numbers of the tigers, which have increased in recent years. And let us look at the other. So Meghamalai Wildlife Sanctuary is an important wildlife sanctuary. So let me just look at Meghamalai Wildlife Sanctuary, as we were looking here. So Meghamalai Wildlife Sanctuary is an extension of Periyar, what it is trying to say. So nice photos. I think I have been to this area. I have been here. Tamil Nadu, Meghamalai, Theni and Madurai. Okay, districts of Theni and Madurai. That means it is on the western edge of the Tamil Nadu. And Western Ghats, that's where it's in the state of Tamil Nadu, and Meghamalai, is it an elephant corridor as well? Yeah, this is the map of that, this particular Meghamalai. Species of wood snake has resurfaced in Meghamalai Wildlife Sanctuary after 140 years. About Meghamalai Wildlife Sanctuary, the wildlife sanctuary is located in the Western Ghats of Tamil Nadu, it's at the western edge. As wildlife sanctuary is at the border of Tamil Nadu and Kerala, hence it acts as a buffer zone for Periyar Reserve, which is present in the state of Kerala. It's connected to Periyar Zone. Meghamalai is also famous for lion-tailed macaque, great hornbill tiger. Wood snake is a point endemic to Meghamalai. It's found only in that sanctuary and nowhere else. Okay.
Okay.
It's close to, it's on the border of, it's in Theni and Madurai district. And recently it has been declared as Meghamalai. Then we go, what are the two Meghamalai? Then Krishnapur Wildlife Sanctuary. Krishnapur Wildlife Sanctuary is Tiger Reserve near Madhya Pradesh, Krishnapur. The Dudhwa Tiger Reserve everybody knows, but nobody knows that the associated Tiger Reserve is a part of Dudhwa Tiger Reserve near Mailani in Uttar Pradesh. It covers an area of 227 kilometers square kilometers and founded in 1972. It is 13 kilometers away from Bidaran Lakshmipur Kheri district. The sanctuary is covered with a dense deciduous forest of sal, teak and jamun. Jamun, nice. Which river is flowing this? Which is this river? Okay. Which river flows? River flows is Uheni and Mahana streams. Krishna provides through which Sharda River flows. Okay. This is nice. This is a nice collection. All these rivers are tributaries of Ghagra River. There was no Sharda River. The Dudhwa Tiger Reserves is a protected area under Uttar Pradesh. The stretches mainly around in Bhairach and Lakhimpur Kheri. Dudhwa National Park through which Suheli and Mahana and Krishnapur through which Sharda River flows, which is a part of as a tributary of Ghagra River, and Katarni Ghat Wildlife Sanctuary with Gerua River. Gerua River. Katarni Ghat Wildlife Sanctuary. Okay. It is also a part of that. The number of species and one horned rhinos is also there, which is important. Wildlife elephant besides enriched fauna. Tiger is also there. Dudhwa Tiger as well. And it is undistributed. It's undistributed natural forest cover vast expanse of grasslands and wetlands. It's important that you have a dense forest as well as grasslands and as well as wetlands over there. So it is only place in UP where both tigers and rhinos can be spotted together. So this is what it is about. And Sri Penusila Narsimha Wildlife Sanctuary and Mahananda Wildlife Sanctuary. So Mahananda Wildlife Sanctuary must be in Bihar. Mahananda. It is located on the foothills of Himalaya, Tista and Mahananda rivers. It is in West Bengal near Darjeeling. Okay. For the first time, a population has been found in Mahananda rivers, Bihar's Kishanganj district. Mahananda is a tributary of Ganga, originates from Himalayas and Darjeeling, and river flows through Bihar, West Bengal, and continues southward to join Ganga at Godagiri in Bangladesh. Okay. And Mahananda. Mahananda Wildlife Sanctuary is located in the foothills of Himalayas. It's close to Darjeeling district, just at the border of South Darjeeling. Can be reached from Siliguri in 30 minutes. Sukna Gateway of to Sanctuary is only 13 kilometers on Godagiri, and Indian bisons and Royal Bengal, which were facing threat, it got status of sanctuary mainly to protect Indian bison and. Okay, so which rivers are flowing? This is a good geographical map. So it has Tista River on the east, Mahananda River, and Balasoniwan, Mechi River, and it has Nepal on one side, Bangladesh on one side, and this is a very narrow strip of land, and it resides in the Siliguri Corridor, which is very Siliguri Corridor, and you know. Geostrategically and also naturally it's important, it becomes an important place. And then Krishna, so we looked at Mahananda and then we have to look at Sri Penusila Narsimha Wildlife Sanctuary. So Sri Penusila Narsimha Wildlife Sanctuary. it's about this. Sri Punasala Wildlife Sanctuary is located in Nellore district of Andhra Pradesh. So we looked at four wildlife sanctuaries. The first was Meghamalai, which is in the western Ghats on the western border of in the Theni and Madurai district of Tamil Nadu. And it is a buffer zone for Periyar Wildlife Sanctuary. And it is inhabited by, it is by four, by, surely it must be elephant corridor as well as it must be a tiger. It's a tiger reserve. It has recently been given that status. Then Dudhwa Tiger Reserve has two, Kedarni Ghat, and the other is Krishnapur Wildlife Sanctuary. These are spread in the Bhairach and Lakhimpur Kheri district of Uttar Pradesh. And the very it becomes Dudhwa Tiger Reserve, and it becomes very important in a nature that both one rhino and tiger can be spotted together in Uttar Pradesh, especially in the western front of the India, I would say perhaps only in Dudhwa Tiger Reserve. So it becomes very important. And then if you go towards south in the Nellore district, then you have Sri Penusila. So this is Sri Penusila Narsimha Wildlife Sanctuary. So Sri Penusila Narsimha Wildlife Sanctuary, protected area and geography. So it is Andhra Pradesh, comprises of unique and endangered forest types, dry evergreen flora. So it has acacias, and pongamia and carissas are. Panther is there, cheetah, nilgai, cow singha, sloth bear, chow singha, but four horn antelope, or chow singha. So antelope found in it, it's a four horn, distinguish it among other, okay, sloth bear, jackal, wild boar, and large number of reptiles and birds species are found in the wildlife sanctuary. It's a shame that most of these wildlife sanctuaries are in decay. Which of the following statements is true regarding the article 323A and 323B regarding tribunals? So now we have to look at Constitution of India. So I'll just go down. Tribunals, Parliament Bay My Law, Education by Trial of Administrative Tribunals, Education or Trial by Administrative Tribunals of Disputes and Compliance with respect to recruitment and conditions of service of persons appointed to public services and posts in connection with affairs of the Union or of any states or of any local or other authority within territory of India and under the control of Government of India, on any corporation owned or controlled by the government. A law made under Clause 1 provides establishment of an administrative tribunal and a separate administrative tribunal for each state or two or more states, specified jurisdiction powers and authority, and tribunals for other matters. Okay. Appropriate legislation by a law. Education of tribunals, complaints respect to all of the matters with respect to legislature. May make power to make laws. Okay, to levy collection of enforcement of tax, foreign exchange, export of custom, industrial labor and disputes, which is there. So 323B, there is an option. So this is covered by the Industrial Disputes Act, the further extension, land reforms, way of acquisition of state defined in Article 31A, and rights areas, ceiling on urban poor property. Elections to either House of Parliament and House of Legislature, but student matters report referred in Article 329 and 329A, production, procurement, supply, distribution of foodstuffs. Okay, and then a rent in the regulation, tenancy. This has recently been done. Okay, the rent in regulation of tenancy, because there has been Model Tenancy Act which has been passed. Then offences against laws with respect to any matters specified, and fees in respect of those matters, any matter incidental to the matters. Okay, a law made under may provide establishment of hierarchy of tribunals, specify jurisdictions, provide for procedure, and exclude jurisdictions of all courts except the jurisdiction of Supreme Court under Article 136. So that means you can bypass the way of High Court with respect to all other matters. And then this is important. D is important. D is, I think, is very important. This particular, and it must be there also as well. Exclude D, jurisdiction of Supreme Court under Article 136 with respect to complaints referred to in Clause 1. Okay, so these administrative tribunals and other tribunals becomes a way to bypass the jurisdiction of High Court. So it does. It does not cover the. It bypasses the. I would say the 226, because if fundamental, if in any decision of such tribunal is hurting, so it must have 226 as well, but it does not have 226. So it is important to note that here in. So 323A and 323B were about tribunals, and there has been question asked here about tribunals. So what was the question? With Article 323A, it provides for establishment of administrative tribunals, while 323 provides for establishment of tribunals for adjudication of interstate river water disputes. It does, but not necessarily that's the only one. Tribunals under Article 323A and 323B can be established both by Parliament and state legislatures. No, I don't think it can be, because 323B has this element that it can be established by state legislature. 323A, I'm not sure about 323A. This is Parliament. It clearly says Parliament here. Provide judicial recruitment service. So 323 is very clear, but 323B is any legislature, the appropriate legislature made by law. So 323 is only for by the Parliament. It will be a statutory law. It will be a law by the Parliament. Whereas this law, 323B, is by any legislature. It says appropriate legislature. So B is not right. This is not right. This is not right. While A, 1 is correct. So only A, 19. What is the answer of 19D? Tribunals were not okay. While establishment provides for establishment of adjudication of this interstate water dispute. And it is 262. Oh man, that is not A. Adjudication of interstate water dispute is 262, 263. It's not here. It's here. In 260. Adjudication of disputes relating to interstate or river valleys. It's clearly a Parliament by law dispute or any valley. It's in 262. And 260 is about jurisdiction of union in relation to territories outside India. It's 262. It's clearly there. And 263 is what? Provisions for Interstate Council. So cannot mess up. So D, none of them are right. In context to regulations and law passed by Britishers in India, the Act 5 of 1843 provided for abolition of economic activities associated with slavery in India and intervention of British court in the event of a trade dispute, regulation of working conditions of women in factories, to increase salaries of officers of East India Company. So I'm not sure. Why this act becomes suddenly important? Because definitely A is not the answer, because economic activities associated with slavery only got abolished in the after 1920s in the 20th century. The intervention by a British court in an event of trade dispute. I think this is important. B must be the answer. Regulation of working. This didn't happen by 1881. This is also not right. Increase of salaries of officers of East India Company. Either it is B or either it is D. So the intervention by the British court in the event of a trade dispute is more likely to be. So 20 must be the B. Let me check the answer. 20. So it's a difficult question. 28, the Indian Slavery Act, okay, 1843, also known as Act 5 of 1843, was an act passed by British under East India Company rule, outlawed many economic transactions associated with slavery. The act states how the sale of a person as a slave was banned, and anyone buying or selling slaves would be booked under Indian Penal Code with an offense and carrying strict punishment. Okay, but this wasn't there in the Penal Code. Some East India Company officials opposed the act, citing the fact that the act would be interference in traditional social structures. Evangelical politicians who had led successful slavery abolition campaigns in the West Indies prevailed, and the act was implemented in India. Okay. So, this is there. Consider the events in the modern history. Guru Vayur Satyagraha, Vaikom Satyagraha, Flag Satyagraha. Which of the events are? These all have happened, I think, in the South mostly. So, Guru Vayur Satyagraha, Vaikom Satyagraha. And also, Guru Vayur Satyagraha took place as a Satyagraha in the present Trishur, and then was a part of Onani Taluk of Marathi Signal, seeking entry for the untouchables into Guru Vayur temple led by K. Kelappan, who undertook the fast for 12 days. However, it was given up on the request from Mahatma Gandhi. Kelappan. Vaikom is a small town located in Kottayam district in Kerala. The famous agitation took place in 1924, known as Vaikom Satyagraha, the first organized movement against untouchability in India. It occupies a major position in the Renaissance movement in Kerala. It was triggered by Kakinada Congress meeting in 1923. K.T.K. Mathavan presented a report on the discrimination in Kerala and blacks of backward Hindus. The meeting decided to promote movements against untouchability. Flag Satyagraha was a peaceful civil disobedience movement. So Vaikom was in 1924, and it was in Kottayam. It was in Kottayam, Vaikom Satyagraha, and Guru Vayur Satyagraha. Even Guru Vayur Satyagraha is in the untouchable in the Guru Vayur temple. K. Kelappan. Okay, Flag Satyagraha was a peaceful civil disobedience movement in the freedom struggle in India, in which people were hosting flags everywhere and had the right to host the flag. The movement mainly took in Nagpur. Place in Nagpur in India, but in other places the movements were at different times. Okay, Flag Satyagraha, 1923. So these were important developments after the Chori Chora incidents and the closure and the secession of secession after the ending of the non-cooperation movement. Coming on to the other aspects, which is we have to be very quick because. See, Guru Vayur Satyagraha happened where Guru Vayur in 1921. Vaikom Flag Satyagraha in 1923. So Guru Vayur Satyagraha 1924. Vaikom Satyagraha happened K. Kelappan, and Vaikom Satyagraha happened 1931. And Vaikom in 1924 and Flag Satyagraha is 3-2-1. And then Flag Satyagraha 1923. Consider the following with reference to fog and mist. The western continental margins are characterized by most fogs than eastern. The western continental margins are characterized by most fogs than eastern continental margins. This is possible because of cold air and hot desert-like conditions. Because of cold air, cold water and hot. Fog contains more moisture than the mist. Mists are frequent over the mountains. I think 3 is right. 1, 2, 3, 23, 22A. Again, I don't know the answer. This is D. I said A. 1, 3, 1, 2. Mist is wrong. Okay. When temperature of an air mass containing large quantity of water vapor falls all of a sudden, mostly due to temperature inversion, condensation takes place. Advection fog. These fogs are thick and persistent. Fog areas are positively related to cool ocean currents. The eastern portion of the continent and western margins are characterized by most fog because the area, the eastern portions of the oceans and the western because of cool western currents. For example, California Current, Bermuda Current, Canary Current, Eastern Current. Hence, statement 1 is correct. Frontal fogs are formed in the high altitude latitudes. To convergence of cold polar masses and warm westerlies. Okay. Radiation fogs are frontal fogs on high because of cold polar air mass and warm westerlies. Radiation fogs are formed in low latitudes on continental areas during winter season where warm and moist air lies over the cold ground surface. Dense fogs are formed at the areas where warm ocean dense fogs of cold and warm ocean currents converge. For example, Japanese coast due to convergence of Kureli and Kurishio current. In urban and industrial centers, smoke provides plenty of nuclei which helps in formation of fog and mist. Mist. The difference between fog and mist is that mist contains more moisture than fog. In the mist, each nucleus is a thicker layer of moisture. Mist are frequent over mountains as rising warm air with the slopes meets a cold surface, hence the streamers is warm droplets also form mist. Water droplets also, but with less merging and coalescing. In the mist, visibility is more than 1 kilometer, but less than 2 kilometers. Okay. So I was stumped on this question. Consider the following statement with reference to oil and gas industry in India during the last 5 years. Indigenous crude oil production has steadily increased during this period. That's true. Import of crude oil has declined during this period. That's false. 1A. 3A. 3D. What is this? Another one, not good. Oil and gas industry is 8-4 industries. India pays major investment from India is expected to grow sharply. So this is the problem. The government adopted policies to fulfill nuclear. India has allowed 100% direct in many sectors, including natural gas, petroleum products, and refineries, among others. So it has decreased. I was not aware. This unit survey organism cell has a definite shape. Food is taken in a specific spot. Food is moved to the spot by movement of cilia, which is then the entire which paracelium. Amoeba is not there. Amoeba can digest food from anywhere. Paramecium. Okay. Moves food using cilia organelles. Which of the following bank assets are characterized as high quality liquid assets? Which of the following banks have been categorized as high quality liquid assets? Cash reserves in excess of required CRR. Marketable securities guaranteed by public sector entities. Government securities in excess of minimum SLR requirements. Government securities within the SLR requirement to the extent allowed by RBI and a marginal standard facility. I don't know, but I don't know. Because this is again a very tough question. Assets are considered to be high quality. They can be easily and immediately converted into cash or little or no value. The liquidity of asset depends on its underlying stress scenario. The volume to be monetized in time can consider. There are two categories of assets that can be included in the stock. Level 1 and Level 2. Level 2 assets are subdivided into Level 2 and Level 2B. 2A and 2B assets on the basis of their price, worth, volatility and liquid assets without any limit, as also without applying any haircut. So till now I have looked into how many questions from 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 8 questions, about 9 questions, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. So about 10 questions I have looked into, and in these 10 questions, all different, I have been bored, I have been stumped in these 10 questions. So it is talking about level 2A, that is marketable securities, which claims guaranteed by sovereigns, public sector. Basically, there is some kind of sovereign guarantee associated with those marketable securities, and there are level 2B securities, which is not guaranteed by sovereign, having risk weights higher than 20% but not higher than 50%. Okay, and so it has risk weights which is lower than 20%, I guess, and they are basically guaranteed by public sector, multilateral development bank. Common equity shares not issued by a bank. Okay, so basically the level 2 has some kind of a sovereign guarantee, whether they are you are buying bonds or whether you are buying certain kind of marketable security of a government owned agency, or you are buying cash reserves in excess of CRR, government securities in excess of minimum SLR, statutory liquidity requirement, and within the mandatory SLR requirement, government securities to be allowed extent allowed by under marginals is also okay. The 10 questions I have looked into. What were these different 10 questions? Let me have a review of that. So I began with the 16th question, which was about polar vortex, about the cold currents, and polar vortex is basically air mass of cold currents on the both the poles of Earth, and it expands during the winter and it shrinks during the summer. And polar vortex basically is not a surface phenomena. It is higher. It happens. It's an air mass which resides at higher up in the atmosphere, but it affects the movement of the jet stream, and it can affect the movement of the flights, which is important to understand. Nuwakhai Juhar is one of the most ancient festivals celebrated in Odisha, so I looked into it. So Nuwakhai Juhar, I looked into Jagannath Yatra, that it was three deities are involved, and it is celebrated in Puri, and it is basically celebrated in the month of Ashad. When Ashad, in the third day of Ashad, it is celebrated. And then I also studied that Nuwakhai Juhar is celebrated in the Pancham Tithi of Bhadrapad, that is a day after Ganesh Chaturthi, that is Ganesh Chaturthi is celebrated on the Chaturthi of the Bhadrapad, Bhapad or Bhadrapad. And the areas of the witch. So Budha Purnima is again a Guru Purnima, and Budha Purnima, the day he was born. So Budha Purnima is celebrated in which month? Budha Purnima, okay. Which month? Which is the Buddha's birthday? Budha Purnima is celebrated in English. I think this is Japan. So Siddhartha Gautama, little Gautam Buddha, founder of Buddhism, okay. So Vikram Sawant, Vaisak.
Okay.
So that's why they call it Vaisak also, Vaisak. Vaisak month. So Vaisak is, but I'm always confused about Hindu lunar calendar months. What are these months basically? So Vaisak, the first month, oh, he was born in the first Punima, first, and then Jyesh, then Ashad is the third, then Shravan, and then what are the, I don't know. Okay. Chaitra. Okay, Chaitra, Vaishak, Jyeshth, Ashad. Okay, it's Vaishak, Jyeshth, Ashad. Shravan. Right now we have Shravan. Savan or Shravan. Then Bhadra. Ashwin, Kartik. Agra, Gaya, Pusa, Bhadra, yeah, sixth month. So Bhadrapada is when Ganesh Chaturthi will come after Shravan. Savan. Okay, then what next I studied? Mahakaya Yoga. Then I studied about the four different wildlife sanctuaries, Meghamalai, which is in Tamil Nadu, the western part, which is in the proximity of Annapolis. It works as a functions as a buffer zone to Periyar Wildlife Sanctuary. It has recently been upgraded to a tiger reserve. The process is under the Wildlife Protection Act 1972, that is NTCA, National Tiger Conservation Authority, is granted the power to declare a particular wildlife. So what are the privileges? That is also one needs to understand. So what are the privileges when a wildlife sanctuary is declared? I think I have to download this particular app. The crux of the matter is that I have to download this particular act. So let me stop the video and then I'll just look into this act. I'll study this particular act later on.